ज्ञानानन्दरसानुभूति सहित स्मेर प्रसन्नाननम् पूर्णेन्दु प्रभमात्मबोधनिलयम् शान्तम् निरीहम् परम् नित्यविचारसारचतुरम् निर्मत्सरम् पावनम् श्रीभूमानन्दमहं नतोऽस्मि कलितानन्दम् परम् श्रेयसे
श्रुतीनां सूत्राणां स्मृतिनिखिलवेदानुवचसाम् परं हार्दं युक्तं ह्यखिलचिदचिद्भिन्नमपि च अभिन्नं स्वाभाव्याद्गुणिज परमं ब्रह्मकमिदं समादिष्टं यैस्तान् अपि सततमीडे गुरुवरान् भाग्योदयेन बहुजन्मसमार्जितेन सत्सङ्गमेव लभते पुरुषो यदा वै अज्ञानहेतुकृतमोहमहान्धकारनाशं विधाय हि ततोदयते विवेकः हरिः क्लोज युवर ऐस् ओपन् द मौत् एण्ड् द हार्ट् सिट् कम्फर्टबलि इरेक्ट् हरिः 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 ओ हरिः ओम् तत्स जय गुरु जनरली इन् आल् अवर् सेशन्स् ऐ फस्ट् आफ् आल् रिसैट् one or two invocations. They are generally in the nature of a benediction, a benedictory verse, or it can be in the nature of a prayer, a prayerful hymn. Now one was, the first was in adoration of all the teachers of Brahma Vidya. You know, our lineage is such that we have a lot of devotion to the spiritual teachers of our country, maybe outside the country also. This loyalty, allegiance, fidelity, indebtedness to the teacher is very, very important. In fact, this is what one shapes the seeker. We cannot become the so-called invisible God. You can never hope to become God as such. But we can certainly become one who has realized that God. In other words, we are only discussing and trying to pursue human realization of God. Realization of God by a human being. So in other words, you may not become God as such, but you have to become a human God. Do you understand the difference between the two? You are all praying. Ultimately, what do you want to become by your prayer? You cannot become God as such. But you can certainly realize God. Now when you become a God-realized person, you are a human with God-realization. Now Guru is the one who depicts and pictures this state before you. Because he is a human being, so you go to him, you have your interaction, human interaction with him. He speaks to you, he makes his thoughts clear, he advises you, gives you instruction, makes timely comments, evaluation, assessment, repeatedly tries to help you examine your own realization. So there is an all-fold interaction. How best you are able to have this interaction will determine how well you will have your realization. If you keep the Guru also at a great distance and you worship him from outside, then it will be just like worshipping the invisible, infinitely distant God. So in our line, Brahmavidya line, you will find the devotion and the indebtedness to the teacher are supreme, unquestionable. That also is a human dimension. Not all human minds are in a position to have this kind of a devotion, devotional proximity or devotional oneness. The moment you go to a spiritual teacher, all your devotion should get focused on the teacher. In fact, the teacher takes the position of God. And there will come a time when you know that in my spiritual and devotional path, it is Guru who comes first and last and not God. That kind of a feeling you will have. God is present everywhere and always. In spite of the presence of God, we are not able to understand Him and realize Him. So what is the factor that is deficient or lacking? Only when the teacher comes and explains to you what is real God, how is God to be approached, what is exactly the realization of God in terms of the human personality, more particularly in terms of the human mind, the human intelligence and the human ego. When I say the mind, intelligence and ego, you should understand how important and crucial they are. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna makes a proposition. What is that proposition? My prakriti is eightfold. What? What is meant by prakriti? I have become. The manner in which I have become. I have become. If God is a being, this world is His becoming. So the manner in which I have become, that is called the prakriti. I have specially become this in order that people will be able to understand me and interact with me. Suppose there was no earth at all with its gravitational force, will you be able to remain on the planet? Huh? Suppose there is no air, will you be able to breathe? If there is no water, will you be able to drink and preserve your life? And similarly, a number of vegetables, vegetative, the entire kingdom, herbal kingdom is there. Now, there are carnivorous and herbivorous animals. Carnivorous animals also eat herbivorous animals. So, it is after all vegetable, vegetative kingdom. Now, eating the vegetables, you have herbivorous animals. Eating them, carnivorous animals are there. So, for our life in this world, vegetation is a must. Now, that is also provided by the earth. So, how many things? Earth. Because we are remaining there and we are getting air, we are getting water and we are getting all the food that we have, then sunlight and moonlight and perhaps light from the other stars also. Now all these together constitute prakriti. God has become in this manner. And if you analyze it, you will find it is a graduated form of expression. From the subtle becoming gross, grosser, grosser and the grossest. Now the earth is the solid form of existence. Water is the fluid form of existence. Air is the gaseous form of existence. These are the three forms of matter, material existence that you can think about. Solid, fluid and gaseous. Then the entire matter and materiality stands over. Then you go to different forms of energy like light, heat, magnetism and the like. Finally, the ground of all these four, that is what you call space. So if you look into it, it is a graduated expression. This is called prakriti. The graduated expression of God is called prakriti. This prakriti, he says, is eightfold. Understand it very well. These are mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. Many people perhaps by heart it and also repeat it, but they don't understand and think about it. That is where your Swamiji and his people differ, if at all. There are many things mentioned in our Shastras, but people will read and simply ignore them, fail to understand and grasp. Bhumi rapo nalo vayuhu, kham. All these five are outside. They are outside our body and objects to our senses. Am I clear? Huh? What? The entire Panchabhutas are outside entities. and they are in front of the senses. The senses alone perceive them. So they are all outside. But these outside elements or constituents will not complete the prakriti. So the prakriti is completed by three more factors. On the one hand, he speaks about the panchabhutas. About panchabhutas, all of you are sufficiently aware of. You attach a lot of importance to the earth, importance to water, importance to air, importance to different forms of energy. But I am wondering, in the same degree, in the same manner, do you attach importance to the next three items that Krishna mentions? Mano buddhirevaja ahankara. What? The five he has mentioned, the other three also he is mentioning. But when he speaks about man, buddhi and ahankara, I don't think you will give them the same importance as you are giving to earth, water, air, energy and space. You tell me whether you give or not. I don't think. You think that mind is something inside the body, as a small item, lesser than a rat or a bee, that's all. That is your idea. But the creative part of creation is with mind, intelligence and ego. These panchabhutas are absolutely inert, insentient. They cannot do anything at all. Panchabhutas are panchabhutas themselves. The creative and the mutational aspect, that comes from only manas, buddhi and ahankara. As are the five, so are these three. The difference between the two also you will not easily grasp. Even if you grasp, you will forget. The entire massive panchabhutas are outside. And mind, buddhi and ego are inside. Not only inside, only inside the human body. You will not find them in an animal body or in a vegetable body or any other body. Even if they are there, they are of a very, very low level of expression. The capacity is very limited. Only within the human body, 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 body. I should repeat it 1,000 times. The difference between animals, non-human beings and human beings, the difference is completely bodily. The elephant has a tongue. The parrot has a tongue. The cow has a tongue. But can any one of them speak and articulate as we do? They also have tongue. They also have lips. They also have teeth. Some of them have. Only the structure of the human body allows you to take up articulation. And we have evolved the alphabets. We have evolved consonants and vowels. And we have evolved words, phrases, poetry. All these are our evolution. And this evolution is primarily ascribable to mind, intelligence and ego. They are not ascribable to the panchabhutas. Our mind can act upon matter and give any shape or any power to the matter. How is it that we are flying on the air? Birds can fly using their wings, but we don't have wings. But without wings, we are not flying, taking a number of people in the air. That is only because of our mind and intelligence. The mind and intelligence alone can act on matter, utilize the matter and harness the matter and energy. So out of the 8 constituents of creation, they are only 8, not 9th. The panchabhutas everybody knows about. The mind, intelligence and ego also they know about. But they are not able to rate them as superior to the panchabhutas. That is our problem. See, the 5 plus 3, Bhumi rapo nalo vayuhu kham mano buddhirevacha ahankara itiyamme bhinna prakriti rashtadha. My prakriti is eightfold. And in the eightfold prakriti, we have got a panchabhautik body. What does it mean? We have a body in which all the panchabhutas are beautifully amalgamated. We have got the solid form of existence, the fluid form of existence, water, blood, then the gaseous form of existence. matter is present throughout the body, water is present throughout the body, air is present throughout the body. What more do you want? Our body is hot, therefore fire is present. And just like space is present in all the four Buddhas, in the four Buddhas in our body, space is also present. So we have all the Panchabhudas in our body. Our body is made up of Panchabhudas. That is why it is called an elemental body or a Panchabhaudik body. In the Panchabhaudik body, we also have mind, intelligence and ego. Then how do you describe or define a human being now? Is he not complete by himself? Boliye na? Is he complete by himself or not? Panchabhudas he has in his body, and the additional three factors he alone has, mind, intelligence and ego. So prakriti wise, are we not sufficiently equipped? Are we not full? I am asking you. Give me an answer. Now, if you are understanding this, are you aware of it always? And do you behave in that manner? Have you developed your mind, developed your intelligence, developed your ego in such a manner that you stand a fulfilled or a fulfilling human being? In Bhagavata, Sri Krishna says, Man lakshanam imam kayam. In Mukti Sudhagara, I was explaining it for minutes and hours. Man lakshanam imam kayam. This human body carries the lakshanas or characteristics of God. Our human body is a replica of God. Provided you understand it. Our body is radiating. Radiating what? Physically and biologically it radiates heat. But don't you think our body radiates also the mental products? Like emotion. When you are angry, I think the anger will be oozing through every cell. When you are loving, that also will be oozing. So our body is actually radiating with not merely physical products like heat and magnetism, but also the psycho-intellectual products like what? Emotion on the one hand, knowledge on the other, and beautiful qualities like confidence, humility, courage, resolve and all that. Man lakshanam imam kayam. See, this one description of human body is something that you have to understand and read about, think about. Man lakshanam, he says, it carries godly characteristics. If you start thinking about the human body, I think it reflects everything in this world. Panchabhudas, the body already consists of. In addition, mind, intelligence and ego. So the entire creational elements are embedded in the human body, embodied in the human body. It is this body that we are living with. While living with and interacting with this world, with this body, you should always understand that you have a full form of creation. Viveka Chudamani is not a religious text. In one or two places he may have used the word God, that's all. I don't know whether he has used it at all. Shankara. You don't find it religious. It is absolutely spiritual and philosophical. We have got three fundamental texts. One text is not one, a set of Upanishads. They are called Vedanta, Vedic Upanishads. They constitute the end portion of the Vedic literature. That is the fundamental one. We have many Upanishads, 144 or so. But 10 of them are considered to be very different and supreme, Dashopanishad. And Shankaracharya has commented for one more Upanishad called Shvetashvatara Upanishad. So it becomes 11. These are the Upanishads in which our fundamental and ultimate thoughts on the world, on the human personality, its potential and possibility, then on the creational source, all these are discussed. But they are discussed. The Upanishads were evolved from a religious background. They started praising the gods and goddesses. Afterwards, they started performing rituals and ceremonies in adoration of them. Thereafter, they found this is not all right. So they retreated and receded from them and started doing mental worship, upasana. When they receded into the mind, they started understanding matters directly and in a very different manner. And that is the portion which is called the Upanishads, the last portion. These are the fundamental texts. Now these Upanishadic formulae or declarations, pronouncements, discoveries, findings, they are lying scattered in different forms in the Upanishads. Now in Brahma Sutras you will find they are rationally and logically arranged in a sequence. If the Upanishads are coming under Shruti, Shruti means what? That which is heard and learnt. Heard and learnt. The one who knows the Vedas, he starts reciting the Vedas, and the seekers and the students, they start hearing. So from mouth to ear, mouth to ear, mouth to ear, this is how everything was learned. So it is called Shruti. Vedas were never written at all earlier. One purpose was that they wanted the Vedas to be learned properly without any mistake and with the Udatta and Anudatta administered to the sound processes. Now if you write, they will start reading themselves. So you can hear it only from someone. When you hear it, you cannot make a mistake because the teacher is there to correct you. So the Vedas were uniformly learned, uniformly learned. So there is a certain piety and religiosity about the Upanishads, though they are philosophical and spiritual. But when you come to Brahma Sutras, it is called completely Nyaya. Say that? Nyaya means logic and reason. The entire Brahma Sutras are logically and rationally written. The first sutra of the Brahma Sutras is this. Athato Brahma Jijnasa. Now therefore is the enquiry into Brahman. This is the first sutra. Now therefore is the enquiry into Brahman. You know the commentary of the sutra will run into pages. Now, what does it mean? When? Now means what? When? You tell me when? When a child is born or when he is about to die? Or when he becomes an adult, or when he completes a certain measure of education, or when he has some maturity, is it that he has to be born in a particular family? So the now is discussed there. Now means what? What is that now? It has to be thought about. Therefore, what is that? Wherefore? Why therefore? The enquiry into Brahman. What is this Brahman? And in connection with Brahman, is it something to be enquired into or to be read about or to be heard about, or we have to walk or fly to reach it? Now all these words will be analyzed properly and the commentaries will go to pages. Now means what? Now Shankara would say the word now means anantaryartha. See, it is not something that one after the other. When he becomes of a certain age, it is not that. Now means whoever has the necessary prerequisites. It's a question of some qualification which the mind and the intelligence begets and presents. What are the qualifications? That is how he has mentioned sadhana chatushtaya. First of all, one must have a kind of a discrimination which points to what is called nitya and anitya. The entire world, when you look at, is changeful and transitory. Changeful and transitory. A transitory world cannot be a perpetual anchor for us. If we are interacting with this world, our body is transitory and the world elements also are transitory. Transitoriness will only get multiplied. I don't get any promotion or elevation. So I must be able to elevate myself from the transitory plight that I have and the world has. So what is that non-transitory element? The Panchabhudas are transitory, my body also. The mind is changeful, intelligence also changes. I sometimes lose my mind. I also miss my intelligence. And the ego also becomes weak after some time. Now, what is it that can be an anchor for me? Whatever I perceive with the senses also is transitory. So where is that non-transitory element? An inquiry of the intelligence or the mind in this manner is called Viveka. This is one qualification. Call it prerequisite. Iha mutra phala bhoga viragaha means what? You must have a real dispassion towards the changeful and the fleeting things of this world and the promised other worlds. So you should not become an aspirant of heaven or Indraloka or Chandraloka. All of them are transitory. And the things you already know that they are transitory. So our objective should not be to gain anything from the world or from the other worlds. This is called Vairagya. Then we have a set of traits called Shamadama Adishatka Sampattihi. Shama, Dama, Tidiksha, Uparati, Shraddha, Samadhana, etc. Now these are some of the characteral and behavioral traits that we must have. Then lastly, a burning aspiration to get freedom from the shackles of the mind and the intelligence. This is called Mukshutva. Now whoever has these four qualities or qualifications, he is fit to inquire into Brahman. Brahman is something to be inquired into because he is already present. You don't have to produce him. And he is present everywhere. Brahman actually it. Brahman is present everywhere. Water is present everywhere in the ocean. And every wave or breaker, bubble, lather, foam, everything is that sea water. So it is everywhere. A presence that is everywhere, what do you have to do? Do you have to reach it? Do you have to gain it? Do you have to produce it? Do you have to attain it? No. You have to discover and realize that it is so. So the inquiry is very, very important. Inquiry is very important. In fact, inquiry is the only pursuit so far as Brahman is concerned. So if you understand Brahman, inquire into it. This inquiry has to be taken up by the intelligence and coupled with the necessary qualities of the mind. You must be steadfast, you must be exclusive, you must be persevering. Just like you will pursue an external object or a goal in this world, you have to pursue this inner goal also. So the tenacity should be there, perseverance should be there, dedication should be there, exclusiveness should be there, loyalty also should be there. Why this Brahman? Janma adi asya yataha. Brahman is defined in the second sutra. Janma adyasya yataha. See, very aphoristic statements. And each statement refers to a world of meaning and relevance. Janma adi asya yataha. Asya means of this whole creation. Janma adi. Where from has it come? So Brahman is the source of creation. It is the anchor for the changeful world. It is where the world, if at all dissolves, will dissolve into. So it is a source, and it is the terminus, and it is the sustenance. Janma adi asya yataha. Now these are the sutras, and there are 500 and odd sutras if I remember correctly. All are completely nyaya, reason. Then we have one more text called Bhagavad Gita, about which you know. But the Bhagavad Gita comes from Mahabharata. So it is called the Smriti.